Good afternoon, everyone. Now is the time for the subcommittee meeting. This is our second community meeting on medical marijuana. And I'm going to turn it over to the city attorney, who will do his presentation at this time. Councilwoman De La Rosa is on her way and be here, but we're not going to wait because we have to respect your time.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Councilmember Lutz, members of the public. This is the second community meeting on this topic. It's the continuation of our conversation, which we started back on November 9th. And I just want to remind everybody that this is being broadcast live. So again, to the extent that you choose to make comments, keep it in mind that it will be broadcast live. What you say, you can't necessarily take back. So just sort of to remind folks of where we were following the November 9th meeting, the council subcommittee directed me to establish a set of rules and regulations to establish a pilot program to allow for the sale, distribution, manufacture, and cultivation of medical marijuana and medical marijuana products in the city of Salinas, allowing up to three of each of the following business types: dispensaries, delivery services, cultivation facilities, with the caveat that it be indoor cultivation only. And then manufacturing and edible production, again, with the caveat that the manufacturing be limited to non-volatile types of manufacturing. And so we're continuing to develop a selection process, and I'll talk about that a little bit more. That's in terms of the applications and the issuance of permits, subject to an RFP, RFQ sort of process, and then the development of a tax in a range of between 12% and 15%. And again, we'll talk about that specific issue a little bit later. So here is a slide showing some of the key elements of the draft ordinance, which I posted on my website, distributed out to the members who chose to sign up on the email distribution list last time. So there's a state license and local permit requirement. There are two levels of permitting that you'll need to meet in order to open a business in Salinas, and I understand that there's a nuance relative to when the state's going to issue its licenses, and so that'll be a sort of wrinkle, as it were, in the ordinance that will work out over the next couple of weeks. Security measures, which were suggested by the police department, show up in section 16B-30.40, and it requires certain level of security in terms of personnel being there, cameras being there, the hours of operation, and all of that, which we'll talk about a little bit more. Like the card room, all of the employees who work there will be subject to a background check. They'll be required to get a work permit from the city of Salinas and an identification card. Again, this is exactly what the employees at the card room have to go through, and so we'll subject the employees of these medical marijuana businesses to the same process, just to be fair and equitable in how we treat our businesses. The location of the commercial cannabis businesses, which is the term that I've used in the ordinance. I think it's also the term that's used in the state law. There's a 1,000-foot buffer that we're suggesting from schools, churches, houses of worship, children's playgrounds, libraries, and public facilities. We wanted to identify those uses which may be most negatively affected by these businesses, and so we established a 1,000-foot buffer, or we're recommending a 1,000-foot buffer. State law has one of 600 feet, but some other cities have something greater than 600 feet. We're recommending a little bit more, 1,000. Cannot operate wholly in a residential area. And again, a 1,000-foot buffer between other commercial cannabis businesses, and this is to prevent clustering of them in certain areas. We're not recommending that there be any specific zoning designation. We're just requiring these businesses to meet these other operating conditions and these buffers, but we're not saying you have to operate in this zoning district or this zoning district. We're sort of leaving that open a little bit. Fees and charges will be established pursuant to a resolution of the council, which will come probably at the end of January, anticipating a January 26 ordinance adoption date, as well as the date at which I'll recommend fees and other things pursuant to resolution to the council. So moving on to the next slide, there is an application process that we will continue to work out over the next couple of weeks. A lot of folks have asked, where are the applications? What are the criteria that you're going to use to evaluate? And we haven't quite gotten there yet. We're continuing to work out these components of this program. In section 16B 30.150, there is a listing of initial criteria that we're recommending be considered as part of this application and review process. Again, as I mentioned, probably on January 26th, they'll bring a resolution forward with additional criteria in the process for selection of the permittees pursuant to this competitive process. A couple of things that I've heard just in comments over the past couple of weeks as I've considered this ordinance were some of the selection criteria. And one of the ones that I've heard quite frequently and one of the ones that I'm recommending is that there be embedded in the selection criteria a local preference. In other words, for folks who have businesses existing in Salinas, folks that have a reputation of established businesses in the city of Salinas, they're in good standing with their existing businesses, we want to give them a preference because they're local folks. We know where to find them if something goes wrong, and they have an investment in this community. We want to continue that investment in this community. Let's be frank, there's a lot of money potentially to be made in these businesses, and so to the extent that these local folks continue to reinvest in the community, we want to give them a preference in this process. We'll identify a selection committee. I won't be on that selection committee. I think that the city manager will be appointing folks to that selection committee. I think the police chief and the community development director will be on that selection committee, but I will stay off it so that I can advise the council as we work through this process. So some of the operating requirements are embedded in the draft ordinance at section 16B 30.190. These are applicable to all commercial cannabis businesses. I've set up a long list of regulations which apply to all of those different four types of business operations. The hours of operation we're recommending between 8 a.m. and 7 p.m. Some of them cut off at 5 p.m., but we're recommending the additional 2 hours for those folks who get off of work at 5 o'clock and need to go get their medication on their way home, so we're giving a little bit more flexibility there. But again, you can't operate on Saturday, Sunday, or any of the holidays. Odor control mechanism, this is particular of interest to cultivation facilities, making sure that you have ventilation and other systems embedded in the operation so that the odors don't go outside of the building and don't affect adjacent properties or businesses. No loitering on or around the business premises. Signage requirements, you can't have a giant marijuana leaf. You can't have somebody standing out on the sidewalk, like those statutes of liberty, advertising for tax businesses. We don't want to see that stuff in the city of Salinas, and so it's been restricted in this draft ordinance. Physicians can't be on site. We don't want there to be a doctor writing prescriptions to those folks who decide to come into the door and start trying to get products. So we're prohibiting physicians from being on site. And then a number of mechanisms for the proper and safe storage of the product, particularly during the off-business hours. All right, so breaking down some of the requirements a little bit more specifically for each of the four types of businesses, and these are in Articles 4 through 7 of the draft ordinances, starting with the dispensaries. So the subcommittee's direction last time was to allow up to 3 dispensaries. That does not necessarily mean 3 all at once, it means up to 3. And so what we're recommending is that during the first 12 months, one permit for one dispensary be granted. There will be a 6-month review period that the city police chief, the community development director, and myself will review the business operations over the first 6 months, see how things are going. We'll come back and we'll give a public report to the council on how things are going. If things are working well, great. If things are not working well, then we can suggest a different course of action, perhaps some additional or some changed regulations, or perhaps the business goes away altogether and we try again with someone new. 12 months after the initial permit has been issued, we'll come back and we'll give another update to the council on how things have gone over that second 6-month period. At that point, we're recommending then the council can consider whether or not it wants to issue additional permits. Remember, there are 2 more that could be issued. So at the end of that 12-month period, you can issue 1 more, you can issue 2 more, you can change the ordinance altogether and allow 50 if you so choose, if things are going so great. Same on limitation on the number in the 6 and the 12-month review period. We're recommending for cultivation facilities, delivery services, and the manufacturing businesses, so that a period of time will apply to all of these different business operations. For cultivation facilities, we're recommending, consistent with the subcommittee's direction, that there be no outdoor cultivation. That does not mean that you can't cultivate it in a greenhouse. A greenhouse would still be considered indoors. But your cultivation needs to be in association with a dispensary. We're recommending that it be on the same site as a dispensary, and there may be some challenges with that, but we can work through those over the next couple of weeks to make sure that the regulations work well. Delivery services must be associated with a local dispensary, and then manufactured cannabis and edibles and the manufacturing processes, and really there are a couple that come to mind that we've attempted to address in this ordinance. One is the manufacturing of edibles, and the other is the extraction of product from the plant itself to create oils, for example. The subcommittee's recommendation was to allow only non-volatile manufacturing, but as I was working on this and doing some research and thinking about the sort of businesses that the city already has in its boundaries, we have a lot of cooling facilities and packing facilities which use some really highly toxic chemicals. themselves. They, to the extent that we're comparing it to volatile manufacturing of medical cannabis, perhaps it's just as dangerous, the existing businesses that we have. So the current draft ordinance allows for both volatile and non-volatile, but we can change that if the subcommittee so desires, but it allows operations to sort of meet the trend where this industry is going. And there are some additional operating requirements embedded in Article 7. So getting to the part that is interesting particularly to me, and I'm sure the council as well, fees and taxes. So there's going to be a resolution that I'll recommend after the development of a nexus analysis over the next few weeks to establish fees to support the program. And then a tax on the business. We're anticipating a June 2016 election. So it means a lot of work for me to develop resolutions and ordinances to put this tax on the ballot before the voters in June. What I'm recommending is that it be established in the ballot that the rate be up to 15%. That does not mean that the initial tax rate will be 15%, but it means that what the voters approve, assuming that they approve it, will be a tax rate up to 15%. The council can set that rate variable based on ordinance or resolution, so you can start out smaller. One of the complaints that I've heard is that these businesses need to be up and running. We can't cripple them with too high of taxes at the beginning. I'm not sure that I personally buy into that philosophy. I think that these businesses are going to be very successful the second that they open. So to the extent that we choose to set a lower than 15% tax rate, we can do so by ordinance or resolution. So for example, some cities around here have a 7% tax rate. You may want to start at 7% to make it equitable, and then you can build from there as the businesses prove themselves and as they continue to generate or as they begin to generate massive amounts of money. The first draft of the ordinance is what you see tonight. Again, this is just the start of the conversation. Folks do not need to provide comments tonight. They can provide comments in writing later on if they so choose. They can schedule meetings with me, but I'm giving a deadline of December 22nd for any comments, whether they be in writing or whether they be through a meeting with me. However, folks choose to submit their comments. December 22nd is going to be the deadline for that. Of course, when we have the public hearings on the 12th and the 26th of January in 2016, folks can come and say what they want, but the work will be done on the ordinance by that point. So additional actions will be brought January 26th. Those are the resolutions that I spoke of, one with respect to the ballot measure for June 2016, and the other with respect to the selection and the criteria review process. When the applications are reviewed and when that first permit or those first permits are issued remains to be determined. It depends on how quickly we can get through that process in January and how many comments we receive. So that's the extent of my presentation tonight, Mr. Mayor and members of the subcommittee. And so I'd like to hear whatever comments the community has at this point.
I'm going to turn over to the community now, and I would like to hear any comments from the community that are present. So the microphone is open for community comments at this time.
Good evening, Mayor Gunter and Councilwoman Lutz and Councilwoman De La Rosa. My name is Gavin Cogan. I'm one of the founders of Altai. I have a couple comments having just read the proposal. One, I think it might be a good idea to have to start out with two dispensaries because dispensaries are different in character of who runs them and what kind of clientele they attract. I think it might be a better study session, if you will, to have two dispensaries that you can track at the same time and see which one works, which model is better for the city. I don't think that having just one gives us the kind of information we need as a community to really understand what model works best and what protective mechanisms work best for our community. So that's one issue. The other issue is because the state is moving at such a rapid pace, in fact, they just passed the Safety Act, also known as MRSA, which I hate to call MRSA, I call it the Safety Act, is they have set up this regulatory system that misses a lot of the plumbing, which I think is something that our community is very strong on. We have already got an ag community with a lot of the distribution, the coolers, the packing, the warehousing. These are all things that the cannabis industry would be using as well, but none of those sorts of licenses presently exist, but they will be issued, and I'd suggest that whatever regulation we pass have some kind of tool in it that allows for mimicry of whatever happens at the state, so we're not having to come back here to issue new permits for new types of uses. That's one concept. Then the last thing I just want to comment on is volatile extraction. So you understand, safe extraction is accomplished through what's called a closed loop mechanism so that the gas is always maintained in a closed loop, and it's the operation of pressure of those gases that extracts the the bionutrients from the cannabis that we use in various medical products. And frankly, it doesn't make much of a difference or in terms of whether it's CO2, a non-volatile, or whether it's butane. The issue with butane, and that we see that has caused all the ruckus, is when they do open blasting and there's all these bottles of butane around and the gas emits and creates a dangerous environment. But if it's enclosed and it's properly regulated and we have city engineering and city fire coming by on a monthly basis and ensuring all the valves are safe, whether it has butane or whether it has CO2, we really make no difference. And as Mr. Callahan put forward, we already have uses in this county that use much more dangerous and much more volatile substances and are controlled satisfactorily. And that kind of comes back to the earlier point I had, which is the extraction of product with CO2 renders a different kind of cannabis product than hydrocarbon extraction, because they use other things, not just butane, but they also use hexane, propane. There's a lot of different products. But the main distinction is that really smokables or ingestibles through the oils that are vaped are usually you get a different flavor quality that's highly sought after. So I think that if we don't allow for hydrocarbon extraction or volatile extraction, if you will, I think we could find ourselves coming back here, to use something Chris said earlier, tearing off the Band-Aid to address this issue down the road. I'd suggest that we at least put something in that would allow for us to expand into this area down the road rather than excise it entirely at the front end. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, members of the City Council. My name is David Spieselman. I've lived here for about 12 years. And before that, I lived in San Mateo County, and I served on town council there. I've been diabetic for 56 years, and I have kidney disease as a result of it, of having lived long past my warranty date. I'm interested in cannabis because it is a good way to control diabetic neuropathy, while alcohol with kidney disease is a terrible way to control pain. What I'm interested in are edibles, and my issue with the edibles is that I believe, and it's missing from the document as it's currently proposed, is that they list the dosage on the edibles on the packaging, and that dosage be tested so that it's within a couple of percentage points, maybe 5% of the listed dosage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, members of the subcommittee. Aaron Johnson on behalf of Coastal Growers Association. First, I'd like to thank staff for completing this task. It's not easy. Coastal Growers Association has also been working on draft ordinances around the county, and it's not an easy task when you think of different land uses in different areas, especially when you're offering something that may conflict from a land use perspective to existing businesses that are there. So I commend Chris and staff for a job well done on creating this ordinance, and I'm glad we're moving this along. With regard to cultivation, first on 16B3010, Chris addressed it, and I think that is an issue. The way it's worded is we wouldn't be able to get a permit until the state law was in effect, the way I read it. And so we do, if we could see language in there that basically said that we would go ahead with some kind of local permitting process while MRSA was being implemented, there's going to be some time in between now and then where we'll be acting according to current law, which is the Compassionate Use Act and SB 420. So so that needs to be crafted a little bit differently, and we'll suggest some language and send that to all of you soon. With regard to cultivation, I would ask that we reduce the size between facilities on cultivation to less than 1,000 square 1,000 feet. it looked to me that that was maybe intended for dispensaries, which I think is okay. But what I'm looking at is you could have a couple of businesses that would fit, you know, in a place like Brunken Avenue or Dayton Street or Abbott, those kind of places, for cultivation that would actually make sense to have them near each other, especially if they're using similar supplies and things like that. So I would ask that when we look at cultivation, we actually increase the number of businesses that are allowed for that use and decrease the available area. That's where I would look at it from a zoning perspective and say, okay, in the industrial areas, that makes sense to us and we'll allow that. But in, you know, obviously not anywhere in the residential areas, things like that. Let's keep it where it belongs. If you want to limit the number, then that's fine. But I think three is too little for cultivation. I think we can have, you know, somewhere around 10, basically, in different smaller buildings. And so I just offer that. When it comes to dispensaries, I'd echo Gavin Kogan's comments that at least two to start off with would be preferred. So we could see a little bit of a dynamic between places and see what we like and dislike. I would also ask that we separate the mobile dispensaries and allow for a couple of those initially. And what I mean by that is what the new law creates with dispensaries is it says that you have to distribute out of a dispensary setting. So whether that or not that means it's a brick and mortar with a storefront that patients visit, or whether it's a secured office that no member of the public has access to, has yet to be seen. And I think the way I read the law is that we can set up offices that are considered dispensaries but that are not open to the public. They're a distribution point for the patients in a mobile setting. And so we can talk a little further about that, but I'd recommend that we take a look at mobile dispensaries having two of them that don't necessarily have to go through the one or two or three in town, but have a very safe, secured cameras, have everything that's required under this act for a facility, but have those in place. So I would ask that we increase that. Finally, I agree with the manufacturing ordinance language. I think that's great, and for the same reasons that Gavin expressed. And then on the tax, I agree with the language as well. I think that we should ramp it up. I've made my voice known on that issue. I do believe there's significant costs with security, et cetera, that come into play that should balance out in the end. So with that, I'm always available for questions, and I thank you very much for your time that you're putting into this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ray DeLoe, a member of the community, a pastor at one of the churches, and I have some other pastor friends that are with me today. I'm opposed to this completely. There are ways already in place. The number one reason why the city is doing this is tax dollars. The number one reason that people are here who want to open them up are to make money. And I'm not against making money either, but this is something that we do not need in the city. And it scares me that I'm not sure what he means by a mobile dispensary. Does that mean we're going to have mobile marijuana trucks parked around the city as we have taco vendors right now? Is that what he means by that? Because that's already in place. If they're worried about that, that's already in place. We have mobile vendors of marijuana right now. So we really don't need to go out and expanse more, other than the fact that the city would get some money. If you're going to tax it, if it's going to happen, and as I listened to Chris's presentation, I think the only thing that's in place has not been decided by the city and by the council is when you're going to do it and how you're going to do it. Whether or not you're going to do it has already been decided. So that being said, tax it. Tax it a whole bunch. Get the full 15% from the beginning. If there's going to make that much money, as Chris says, and I agree with him, they're going to make tons of money, tax them. Get every dime you can back. Why I'm concerned about ordinances within the city of Salinas, and this is my will be my last point, is we have a ton of ordinances already that are ignored and not enforced. I do not see a track record that is going to show me that our city police officers, our city chief, our city manager, our fire chief are going to enforce this ordinance when we already have a ton of them that aren't enforced. And if they want to see where they are, just come over and visit where I live. I can take them down and show them the cars that have been parked there for a week now, the mobile home that's been parked there for over a week, the trucks that come in and park where they're not supposed to. Just come on down. I'll show them where these things are at. So I oppose this completely. People can get their medical marijuana without the city getting involved in it. They're already doing it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, Council. My name is Jackie McGowan. I am a member and board member of Monterey County Normal. I'm also a patient, though, and I'm what I call a sophisticated patient. I require different types of non-psychoactive derivatives of cannabis, which require manufacturing. This is THCA, so it's medicine that I can actually get the benefits of THC without the psychoactive effects. I've waited 2 years for the medicine to evolve into this state, and currently it is only available in 2 dispensaries in the entire nation, one of them being in Oakland. So I want to let you know, I speak out around the state, and I visit farms, and what I'm watching right now with a large cultivation center outside of Sacramento is their business model is broken because they don't have access to manufacturing. If you're going to issue cultivation licenses, you have to issue just as many manufacturing licenses, and we need to start having the discussion about volatile and non-volatile. I'm not a patient looking to get high, and I cannot buy this on the street. Okay, think about that. I'd also encourage you to, start the tax out at 10% and see what happens with the black market. Colorado started their tax out at 10 and they're actually lowering it to 8% in order to combat, combat the black market. So the discussion definitely needs to be had looking at this from a business standpoint. If Salinas gets on board with this and understands it from seed to sale, you could be the next nutraceutical company, and that is the way that this movement is carrying out around the state. There are 19 states with marijuana, either decriminalization, medical or recreational on the ballot in 2016. We've passed the tipping point. What we could see happen overnight is our borders open up and those cities that are positioned to produce the best medicine this country has ever seen will never regret it. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. So I look forward to working with you.
Thank you.
Good evening, council members. My name is Aram Stoney, Monterey County resident. I would just basically like to second what Gavin and Aaron both said. As I look at this draft, my biggest areas of concern would be how you address delivery and cultivation primarily. Cultivation should not necessarily be attached just to the dispensary. You need to have a number of them that have the opportunity to spread their wings, if you will. And mobile dispensaries are a whole nother entity, if you will, as well. They don't need to be attached to an actual brick and mortar. They may carry other medicines that the brick and mortar may not carry, and it adds to the diversity. As the one gentleman said, there are delivery services that are operating currently, and many of them are operating very well with integrity and really helping the community. So Aaron had a great idea. I don't think 2 is enough. I think you need to open it up to more than 2. And that's really all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak from the public at this time? Seeing none, we will close the public portion at this time and come back to the committee. I will ask each of my members to speak briefly on their opinion on the ordinance as it stands right now. But before we do that, this matter hasn't gone to the full City Council yet. It will go in January. The information will be shared with them. The input from the public will be given to them. We are also surrounded by the county, which is currently working on their own ordinances that cover marijuana, which will cover large areas of cultivation that I'm sure most of you are aware of, with the number of greenhouses right outside the city. So it's not like we're an island that sits in nowhere. You can drive a few minutes in either direction and run into a fine greenhouse that probably is looking for a crop to be grown soon of some kind. So, Councilwoman Lutz, any comments?
No comments. I want to thank everybody for being here. Mayor, your comments about the fact that there are going to be a lot of dispensaries helps at least ease my concern, because I thought that was an interesting point, that two dispensaries rather than one, because one doesn't give enough information. But I wasn't quite sure I understood that there are different models of dispensaries. So that was an interesting point, and that's all I have to say.
Comments, Councilwoman De La Rosa?
Mine is mostly on the mobile dispensaries. That's what I'm really, questioning. And, it is a difficult decision for a lot of us that are here, and we can all, voice our what we think is right. But I want to remind everyone that this is medicinal, and that there's a lot of community members that I know personally, family members, people that do attend religious services, that are taking Vicodin opiates, that unfortunately they become dependent to the point where they're in a lot of severe pain, and some of them, unfortunately, have had to seek, and I'm glad that there's rehabs that they have to go to get off of those opiates, because your body wants more and more. And I have seen what these oils can do and these eatables that they have, and where some people have gotten off of the opiates, and that's why I am convinced. And also that I need to remind you that the Visiting Nurses Association, the hospice, they are supporting this ordinance. So again, we all can have different opinions, and that's why I think we're going to be doing the right thing. We need to make the regulations, we need to do it the right way and not have the state come and tell us what to do. That's the scary thing. So, and thank you for bringing this forward. And I think that I like the 12% on the tax.
Okay. Wow.
Thank you.
First of all, I want to thank everyone for being here. And I want to make everybody well aware of, if you came in a little late, City Attorney Chris Callahan has worked very diligently on this, and he has opened it up till December the 22nd, and he expects to hear from all of you in writing, I'm sure. We won't be able to talk to him. He'll be in there with his door closed working on this. So there is a lot of work to be done by all of us, and this is a work in progress. So, and I know people wanted to have 12 distribution centers, some want to have 150 grows, but it's something we have to work with the community and decide what direction we take, and with the medical and with what regulations are handed at us. So without further ado, I want to thank everybody for coming, and Mr. Callahan will be readily waiting for all of your written responses. So thank you very much for being here tonight.